Thank you, Dr. D'Souza, for inviting. This being prelims, I will be very brief and I promise to avoid a study. So let me start with this photograph of Mr. Clyde Sills. Excuse me. Dialysis was invented much earlier, but only in late 1960 the MSD was started, mainly because before that we never had something like vascular access. So this was the first gentleman in whom the maintenance hemodialysis was started. He survived for 11 years, all because of something like this, which I hope is still being practiced in Gangaram. And we as nephrologists, we are being providing good quality to our patients mainly because of this. This fistula is actually the lifeline. This is not just an stenosis of artery and vein. Basically, this becomes a site of union between man and the machine so that patient can live longer. And if this site is healthy, patient remains healthy. But as you know, all precious things are fragile. So to start with also, all fistulas are not very easy to prepare. In fact, most of them will even fail to mature, and most of them even fail before 3 months. So that is called early failure, which is up to in 1/3 of the cases. And there is something called late failure. Even if a fistula has matured properly, it is likely to get less inadequacy whatever is prescribed. Okay, this is not being achieved and this may actually even close. So that is called late failure. So this is the figure. At the end of the 1 year, maybe only 60 to 65% of the fistula might actually be working. But as I told, AVF is lifeline. Fistula is as important to us as the coronary arteries are important to the cardiologist. So before we understand the reasons behind the failure, let us understand the pathology of AVF failure. That is mainly because of non-maturation of the fistula as I discussed, and also because of thrombosis and also because of the stenosis. There are two major groups, one is local and other is systemic, but actually these are not two different compartments. For example, imagine a diabetic patient with calcified vessel undergoing fistula formation. Now this vessel was bad because of a systemic reason, and local factors will be always operating. The patient will be under dialysis in the future, and because of the arrhythmia and malnutrition, he will become more arrhythmic and then fistula will fail further. And apart from this, these two factors, local and systemic, they also merge at the molecular level. Apart from systemic conditions which we normally know of, such as age and sex, there are some other groups where there is hypercoagulability. Patient is more prone towards making thrombus. Some of the factors such as protein C, S deficiency and other which have been enumerated. And there are also some acquired hypercoagulable states such as cancer, obesity. Now coming to AVF failure, because of systemic conditions which we commonly face in the dialysis patients, although today it is possible to study fistula in animal models such as pig and mice, but to start with, the pioneer work was done by Dr. Jarry, and who studied the internal carotid artery anatomy and physiology. And three factors were identified: intimal thickening, low flow and shear stress. Shear stress is dependent upon the viscosity of the blood and caliber of the vessel, and exactly these three factors are also operable when we talk about fistula. Both are directly linked. When the fistula is created, we artificially create more flow in the vein, and that is important to develop a physiological maturing of the fistula. And there has to be a perfect balance between blood flow and the shear stress, and the balance when it becomes abnormal, then your balance is towards a weakening fistula. There is also concept of transmural circumferential pressure that also helps in maturing the fistula. So this is how it can be summarized. Increased arterial and venous flow will lead to intimal thickening, and arterial venous dilatation will lead to medial thickening. Ultimately, we will be having a mature fistula. When the intimal hyperplasia, which was physiological, becomes pathological, and when the vascular modeling is abnormal, then the fistula starts taking a bad shape. There is also a concept of reactive oxygen spacing. Here you can see an increase in shear stress that increases superoxide production. Here, the superoxide is beneficial if it works in concordance with nitric oxide. And because of the balance between the two, a mature fistula works. And it has been shown in mice model that when this superoxide is not working, then fistula doesn't mature. This is another slide showing the convergence of local and systemic factors. whenever there is local damage in the fistula, actually epithelial, endothelial cells from the bone marrow come for the repair of the fistula. I will skip this. And this is another slide again mentioning that whenever there is local damage and leading to local fistula failure, actually it is through the mediators which are systemic in origin. So local factors cannot be ignored when we talk about systemic things. That could be bad anatomy to start with, bad needling, pressure at the local site. You must have seen residents in ICU where they just tie hand of a fistula patient. By the time you come for round, the hands are tied. Thrombogenic drugs and indifference of the technician who are not actually doing active surveillance, and also the indifference on the part of nephrologist. Actually, some of the systemic factors can be manipulated, such as they have proved in the randomized trial that diflunisal, fistula and clopidogrel is actually beneficial. And in one of the retrospective studies, they have even seen ACE inhibitor to be beneficial. And also there has been some talk about sirolimus and oxygliatazone, and also in experimental model gene transfer is being tried to improve the systemic factors which are working towards the fistula maturity. Now let us enumerate very quickly the factors which are otherwise important in our day-to-day patients: age, sex, race, obesity, dyslipidemia, diabetes, peripheral vascular disease, anemia, EPO, homocysteine, smoking, CMV, malnutrition, hypotension and uremia. These are some of these topics are well studied and non-controversial. They are very easy to understand. Some of them are controversial. Because of lack of time, I will just briefly mention one or two slides each. Aging is a universal phenomenon. As you age, your vessels are also going to age and fistula has to lose. So as the longevity of the patient will improve, you will be facing more and more fistula problem. Coming to the sex. Now it's a difficult question. In some of the studies, such as two has been quoted down, fistula failure is more in females. On the other hand, there are few feminist studies, they say that it's same in the female. But as far as general practice is concerned, in my center at least I found that more females are getting fistula failure. I do not know whether that is because of our women being more obese or something, whether local factors are working or systemic, I do not know. Coming to the race, this has been studied that Caucasians have more chronicity towards your fistula failure. India being a mixed population, it's very difficult to judge how our patients behave. But there is also something called gene polymorphism which is working for the fistula failure, and you will find some people having very good fistula and some people having very bad fistula. Coming to obesity, unlike our popular belief, obesity does not improve, does not deteriorate the chances of your fistula failure. Dyslipidemia is extremely confusing. Some of the studies have shown that high cholesterol is associated with your fistula failure, and most of the studies have told otherwise, that actually low LDL is associated with high fistula failure. This could be probably that in some of our patients, dyslipidemia, low cholesterol is actually because of malnutrition, and which is a chronic inflammatory state. Coming to diabetes, diabetes also, it's not that simple, it's confusing. Because some of the studies show that fistula failure is more, some of the studies show that although initial graft loss is there, or initial fistula loss is there, but in long run it is same. There is unfortunately no meta-analysis for the consensus. Coming to peripheral vascular disease, most of our patients present late, and their vessels are like this. If you do the X-ray, it looks as if you have done the angiography. So if you have calcified vessel to start with, the fistula will not be successful. And also bone mineral disease, if it is uncontrolled, that is going to be a problem. And there is a big problem, and that is of substitution. Suppose you want to manipulate calcium and phosphorus, you write this in your ESI patient, they will definitely give a calcium product which is mixed with vitamin D and maybe even with a magnesium. So people do not even handle calcium magnesium in a manner it should be handled. Similarly, hyperparathyroidism becomes a very neglected case that is also important for fistula failure, and also the oxidative stress which our patients are undergoing. Coming to EPO, when initially EPO was there were a lot of studies and apprehension whether EPO will decrease the fistula life, but in a randomized control there are few studies which show that EPO does not disturb the life of the fistula. But later on, when they started targeting your high hemoglobin, then probably things have changed. So 10 years back in good studies, EPO was not harmful. But today I think there is something called the tonic effect, especially in the people like CGHS. They will never like that you decrease their EPO doses. They will always like 4,000 three times a week, and they are very happy with 13 hemoglobin. I have patients, I want to reduce, but he will not let me do so. So that Popeye effect, that I think when we try to achieve unrealistic hemoglobin, remember I told about shear stress. If you have high hemoglobin, you have high viscosity, you have hypoglobulinemia state. Similarly, if you have BPO doses which is non-physiological, that will lead to fistula failure. Similarly, iron doses, they think that iron is also a tonic, and sometimes we also write and we forget to stop. That may also lead to oxidative stress. Coming to homocysteine, it was a fashion about 10 years back, then it became flop. But I think we cannot directly extrapolate the cardiac studies in the renal patients. In our patients are actually deficient in folic acid and vitamin B12, so homocysteine well might be playing. And if they are deficient in that, that may be creating a hypercholemic state. Coming to smoking, it's a big chart. I don't want to go into the detail. We all know a smoking will lead to your fistula failure and also the entire peripheral vascular disease. And believe me, some of these patients are so obstinate that I have a patient who is 10 years on dialysis and I failed to convince him that smoking is bad for him. Coming to CMV. There was also a time when people started thinking that CAD is actually an infectious disease. That fashion has gone. But in most of the studies, they proved that CMV disease is actually associated with high fistula failure. There was one recent study in 2011 which told that actually this is not so. There was another study in the same year which showed, you know, actually that is there. But probably that is mainly because that when we talk about the fistula, this is not only the one factor which is mattering. This is a consistent few factors in combination, because one latest study was just trying to evaluate the infection malnutrition cascade, and they found that if the patient is malnourished, infected, then chances of fistula failure will be more. Coming to hypertension, as I told, blood flow, if it is less, then it will lead to altered remodeling of the fistula. And as the patient is a little older on the dialysis, there will be low blood flow because of various factors such as ischemic cardiomyopathy, general cardiomyopathy, or amyloidosis of chronic hemodialysis. Coming to uremia, uremia per se makes you more vulnerable towards the blockage of fistula, and there is actually a vicious circle. Uremia leading to bad fistula leading to bad dialysis leading to uremia, and that leading to bad fistula. So coming back to the factors which I enumerated, I very briefly enumerated these factors, but sometimes it is not very clear that which fistula will work and which fistula will not work. So there are fistulas which were created in 1960s and that are still working. So definitely, whatever our knowledge improves in the field of genetics or molecular biology, but most important remains our technicians, our doctors and our patients. So that is what I feel, that actually this has to be a symphony between surgeon, patient and dialysis technician. And when we talk about surgeon, when I came to Faridabad first, it was just dialysis was developing in that area. And I even didn't know who is going to make our fistulas. Somebody told me, get hold of urologists. Then some plastic surgeon came. Then some general surgeon were also trying. Then it was not very clear that the cardiovascular surgeon is the cardiac surgeon or he's the vascular surgeon. And then somebody told that nephrologists are better preparing. But then I also got scared, because when I was a nephrologist and when I learned my fistula, first fistula, in fact, my senior who was teaching me just disappeared in the process. So when the nephrologist is learning the manner that fistula becomes a training ground, then you are really scared that what fate will this fistula be locked. And so I believe that fistula is actually a piece of art. And I do not know whether some of you have seen this movie. In this movie, this monkey was making paintings which was superior and costlier as compared to the painting prepared by Bobby Deol. So it doesn't matter who is preparing fistula, but passion, commitment and creativity is more important. And if that is there, then you will have good fistula. Coming to the patient, then patient needs to be compliant. He should be taking adequate dialysis. You should not be hammering your head again and again, three times is better than two. You should have a good lifestyle such as sugar control, weight control, healthy diet, non-smoker habit. You should be having exercise to keep good blood flow and having a stamina of the heart. And of course, regular nephrological supervision is required. Sometimes I have seen that we talk about lot of our BK virus, we may not be seeing more than 2 patients in a year. But we are seeing 20 dialysis patients a day, we don't even bother to take morning rounds. So that is where surveillance is required. Coming to the technician, a good rapport is required between fistula and the technician, which Dr. Mahajan was mentioning. In our unit, I ensure that some of my patients are given to some of the technicians and the same person is actually using that person. The fistula should know the technician and technician should know the fistula. And I started with Clyde Shills and I want to end with Dr. Robin Eady. Dr. Robin Eady, if you read the biography, then you realize that this was the person who was started on hemodialysis in 1963 while he was a medical student. Then he became a dialysis technician. Then he became a doctor again. He continued on dialysis for more than 22 years, then got transplanted, and he is the longest surviving person of ESRD who has remained in, is healthy after 50 years of renal failure. But what is working here? He is doctor himself, he is technician himself, and he is patient himself. So this symphony, that perfect balance between your dialysis unit and doctor and the patient is working here. So I think that is the most important systemic factor which will keep your fistula patent.